All right, everybody, yo, we got a Billboard Breakdown Hot 100, September 7, 2024. TA's Short and Sweet. Drags you to try. Go.
Hey there, I'm Mark from Spectrum Pulse. And yep, nearly all Sabrina Carpenter this week. And this, it's Billboard Breakdown. Think about me every night. Oh. I don't remember. Not gonna lie, this is the sort of week that feels like a mixed blessing. Yes, I'm happy that we got an album bomb for a project that I already discussed at length, largely just really replacing the position.
I forgot, he doesn't really like Sabrina Carpenter. Bomb,
and that'll hopefully keep this relatively short on
think
a day
about me
a lot of other
every
things
night.
To get
oh.
ahead of right now, and hell, the episode's late as it is. Unfortunately, it's for Sabrina Carpenter, and the album is merely decent, and there's a part of me perversely wishing that we got a bit more of Travis Scott's Days Before Rodeo instead, especially as said album bomb is small enough to be covered in its near totality, given that it nearly all landed in the top 40. Just my luck. Anyway, our top 10, where, to my absolute shock,
my baby
Sabrina Carpenter did not snag the top
she's been telling
spot
me all night long.
Her song Tipsy by Shaboozey.
Yeah, I didn't expect the song
one.
To really.
It just looks like a case of inertia that's holding sway. It slipped
do this well
streaming and airplay is on
thought
the
it would just peak
swing,
at three and then just kind
of a margin that it was
you know lurk in the top
in first
the lower
top
10.
10 the fight it was there Taste by Sabrina Carpenter at number
oh
two
God.
With streaming dominance oh. and good sales
I need
but not good enough especially when
bro I need to get Jack and Rich no guys no guys
okay, I'm gonna be 100% like shit. I wanna be 100% honest. Like, I'm not gonna joke with you. I'm gonna be like 100% straight up, okay? Right? I wanna be famous so bad. Like, you guys have no idea how much I want to be famous. Well, firstly, I wanna be rich, right? Everyone wants to be rich, but I want to be rich. Like, look, you're probably wondering, like, oh, why did he switch to his main channel? Why did he do that? Because I was monetized, right? And I'm not saying that I'm doing it for the money, which I'm not. I mean, the shorts, yeah, I'm doing it for the money. Those fucking YouTube shorts are fucking terrible. But, like, bro, I want to make money doing, like, something that I love doing. Something that I love. And something that I love doing is this. I love doing this. I love creating content. I love reacting. I love gaming. I love doing all that. I would love to be, like, a popular content creator. You know what I'm saying? And I know this somehow, like, came off from Sabrina Carpenter. But look, bro. I'm, like, seriously, I'm trying my hardest to be successful. And, you know, when it fails, and which my main channel is not doing very good right now, I'm gonna be straight up. It's not doing very good. Please go subscribe. It's not doing very good. And when I see that, it's discouraging. But I know deep down I can't stop. You know what I'm saying? I love doing it, but also, like, you know, it's just kind of like, damn, maybe I'm not built for this. You know what I'm saying? Maybe I'm not built for this. I'm probably not built for this, but I want to do it. That's why I keep going. You know what I'm saying? That's why I experiment with things. Like, I recently did, like, some show reaction to, like, Modern Family Bleach reaction. I unlisted them because I realized I made a mistake. Like, I changed that ASMR channel. I changed it a lot. I completely switched. And that's very hard to survive as a YouTube channel. When you do a huge switch, you're gonna lose a lot of viewers, right? It was going well the first weeks, but now it's like, okay, I'm really seeing, like, yeah, like, not really many people are tuned into it, right? And that's fine. It comes with the process. Not everyone's gonna be immediately successful with what they do, right? It is very discouraging. And man, like, my main goal, dude, is, like I said, to just, like, make money, like, doing what I love. Like, I don't want to be in a 9-to-5. I don't want to be in an office. I don't want I'm going to go to college, but I don't want to do, I don't want to do that stuff, right? And I know there's a lot of people who don't want to do that stuff, but I know there is a lot of people who do want to do this stuff, and that's fine. But if I don't make it as a content creator, if I don't, like, make a living off of this, I think I would never be able to live that down. And I think that really hurts, knowing that, while also seeing me kind of fail at the same time. You know what I'm saying? Like, it feels so... It just feels like I'm stuck. You know what I'm saying? You may not know what I'm saying. It feels like I'm stuck. You know what I'm saying? And you're probably saying, oh, wow, no, why? What's... The problem with doing, like, the content that I do, the music content, is you get no money from it. That's the thing. You song reactions, like, even, like, this stuff. I'm not even making money from this channel yet, but... All these videos, they get partially blocked, and they would all be demonetized if this channel was monetized. And on my main channel, all the videos with any type of music in it, some of them kind of fly under the radar, but most of them, they're not monetized. And that sucks. That sucks. And you also got to look in my shoes. You know what I'm saying? I'm 16. You know, I have a little job on the side, right? But I'm at my years where it's like, bro, I don't want to, like, I don't want to be in a 9-to-5. I don't want to have to work normally. I want to live my dream life. And my dream life would be doing this and, like, making a living off of this and having fans and being able to interact with my fans, be able to do stuff with fans. You know what I'm saying? And it sucks to see a lot of hard work you put in fail. But the thing I always gotta remember is that I have to keep going. But as you keep going and failing, the more motivation you lose, and it just sucks. You know what I'm saying? Like I said, it's not the stuff that I do is not for the money. You know what I'm saying? A little bit is, obviously. But like I said, I love doing what I'm doing right now, and I would love it more if I made money off it. You know what I'm saying? Like, that will make me want to do it more, and that will be more content for you guys, right? And I don't blame the viewers. I don't blame them. I blame myself. Because my main channel, I'm going to be honest, I probably should not have done that. I probably should have not transferred all that that type of content to the main, to my ASMR channel, basically, the ASMR channel that I had. And it sucks to think about, like, what if I didn't do that? And I think, like, what if I do go back to ASMR? It's just a lot to think about. It's a lot to think about, you know what I'm saying? And then I also have, like, TikTok on the side. That's just... You guys don't know about the TikTok stuff, but... All right, I'm sorry. I yapped a little bit. I'm yapping a little bit. I'm sorry, guys. I just had like a little moment. I had a little moment. It's fine.
Please, 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 by Sabrina.
Anyway, back to my original point. Sabrina Carpenter's so bad. I need to get rich and jacked so I can be her boyfriend. There you go. That's what I wanted to say.
Carpenter number three.
That's what I wanted to say.
Streaming did get that spike. It only has about half as much radio as Shaboozy does right now. She just could not make up the margin. And while Espresso by Sabrina Carpenter also saw the expected streaming push to get it back to number four, radio does not care about album bomb positioning, and wavering on that margin meant that she just could not make up the difference. Now all this knocks back I Had Some Help by Post Malone featuring Morgan Wallen down to number five. Looks like it's
everybody across the board
now that the summer is very much over, especially on the radio. And that could open up the door for Die With A Smile by Lady Gaga and Bruno Mars down at number 6, but it's in an interesting place with stable streaming and sales and radio rapidly making up that gap. I have seen some projections that have this making a run for the number 1 spot. We'll have to see if it pulls off that landing. I personally have some doubts. Then we got Birds Of A Feather by Billie Eilish at number 7, just a bit of of a lag on the radio push, as this feels more like a positional loss than actual fading traction. And it's a similar observation I actually have for Good Luck Babe by Chappell Roan at number 8, which really is neck and neck with Billie Eilish right now, and it's really trying to overtake her on the radio, and it might get close. Now compare this to Not Like Us by Kendrick Lamar down to number 9, where the radio growth has absolutely stalled out, but the real cause for concern is probably streaming falling off sharply. It might rebound when the album bomb fades, but we'll gotta see there. I don't have high hopes. Finally, somehow still stubbornly holding on, we got Lose Control by Teddy Swims at number 10. What can I say? It's got a good streaming week, and it did not lose radio as quickly as I was expecting. It held on, at least for now. Hell, it might even bounce up. But on the flip side,
that's crazy. If it bounces up, if it bounces up,
week, there really was not that many, mostly because Sabrina Carpenter was, again, just effectively replacing Post Malone. But in the latter group, we did see I Remember Everything by Zach Bryan and Casey.
I remember everything.
On the charts a year, alongside We Can't Be Friends, Wait for Your Love by Ariana Grande, handily clinching a year-end list spot for 2024, and Bulletproof by Nate Smith, likely just being on the borderline. And then for our losses, let's get through all of Post Malone's first. Pour Me a Drink with Blake Shelton off the gain down to 25. Guy for That with Luke Combs off the gain to 36. Losers with Jelly Roll at 55. Wrong Ones with Tim McGraw at 72. California Sober with Chris Stapleton at 89. Nosedive with Lainey Wilson at 91. And What Don't Belong to Me at 92. Outside those, well, Guess by Charlie XCX featuring Billie Eilish.
Booty. Lower back tattoo.
As did It's Up by Drake, Young Thug, and 21 Savage to 63. And then we had Nasty by Tinashe lose any residual album impact to 90. But the one that concerns me most might be Red Wine Supernova by Chappell Roan down to 53. I think it's gonna rebound when the album bomb fades, but it's really only this high thanks to streaming. Clinging to more success or maybe getting an airplay push might be pushing her luck. But alright, what about our returns and gains? Well, we had more returns than I expected, mostly stuck at the very bottom of the Hot 100. Am I Okay by Megan Maroney at 94. Prove It by 21 Savage and Summer Walker at 96.
Blue-eyed people really be staring at you like that.
Pushing this to the radio when I was not paying attention.
Wait, what?
96. And Megan Maroney at 94. Prove It by 21 Savage and Summer Walker at 96.
What?
Apparently someone started pushing this to the radio when I was not paying attention. I'm quite frankly shocked that 21 is still trying to work that album from earlier this year.
Yeah, what?
Close to You by Grace Abrams at 99.
It's like hella late. Girls, that song, that song was like 7-8 months ago?
When we shift over to our gains, she saw a boost off her losses to I Love You, I'm Sorry to 75. Although that's a bit of a mixed blessing, because while we also saw Hang Tight Honey by Lainey Wilson get a nice album-related nudge to 67, we also got Lonely Road by Machine Gun Kelly and Jelly Roll rise to 64.
Rising to 64? What the hell?
Gigi Perez got a jump off the debut to 80. But I'm a little bit more perplexed as to why Beautiful
As
You by Thomas
Rhett got beautiful as you.
I was just caught off guard that it saw so much traction for being a nothing of a pop song. Go figure. But all right. Now on to our full list of new arrivals, and get set for a lot of Sabrina Carpenter.
Oh, really? Fuck, I did. I should have listened to that shit.
Number 66,
yeah, whatever.
Drugs You Should Try It by Travis Scott. Twice, I've been down and lost for days. Glad I found you on the way. Truth be told,
got some hard nipples.
Travis Scott put Days Before Rodeo on streaming proper. I was expecting a lot more of a crossover to the Hot 100, given how much of a cult hit that mixtape is. But this was the only song that crossed over, and, well, I'm not that surprised that this is the one song that returned as a slow burn track that's for the ladies, that probably crept into the moody, slow burn playlist over the years with the ragged guitars, spare snap, reversed, and haunted vocals, and the shuddering trap whirs. Honestly, on a textural level, I rather like it, especially with Travis murmuring through the grit of that guitar distortion, very much a thing of the mid-2010s that I like. Of course, Travis's writing leaves a fair bit to be desired, with lines like, when the day gets brighter, the night gets nighter. But in terms of the hazy grit of doing drugs with the girl in the hills, where space and time begin to stretch out and warp, I kind of get the appeal. It does feel like a very primitive version of songs that Travis would do later on, but there's a lack of polish here that, in my opinion, works to his advantage. I prefer this sort of texture to his hedonism than what we have now. And I guess for that, decent enough. I'll take this. Number 41, Lie to Girls by Sabrina Carpenter.
So lie to girls. If they like you, they'll just lie to themselves. Like you, they'll just lie to themselves.
Okay, what does that even mean?
The song I think is the worst on the album just so happens to be outside the top 40 and thus winds up qualifying under my album bomb rules anyway. Just my goddamn luck. I'm going to try to keep these Sabrina Carpenter entries as short as I can.
This dude does not like Sabrina Carpenter.
I already reviewed the project at length. And here,
so bad.
I have no idea why Jack Antonoff is dodging the critique with this album in particular, because it's painfully limp with the brittle acoustics and the fizzy reverse percussion and the underpowered stutter. Yeah, it's airy and filmy, it sets a vibe, but it's not like Sabrina Carpenter is bringing much in the way of power to actually stand out beside some of the multi-track leads, and that only reminds me that... Well, Taylor Swift does this far better on the regular. She has for years. At least she
and
would have the dignity
for,
to not protest.
Nah, that's going on my best list.
Ripe with substance abuse.
Shit.
With the line, "You don't have to lie to girls. If they like you, they'll just lie to themselves." The sort of blame shift.
I don't know what that means.
On women that had me wondering if Julia Michaels was co-writing this song. Yes, I know that it's trying to be more of a dismissive kiss off to this guy, but I hear "I can change him" echoing between every line. Line of the presentation to place this guy on a pedestal he probably does not deserve. And even if it might be realistic to her emotions, it utterly gives the
didn't
game
say
away
he would keep
for
this
the rest
brief?
Of the project's bite. And I can't stand this. Next, number 35, yeah. Don't Smile by Sabrina Carpenter.
What's with smiling? Die with the smile? Don't smile? What should I do? I'm conflicted. I mean, honestly, I'll do anything that Sabrina Carpenter tells me. So, yeah, I mean, I guess I'm not smiling.
I don't mind the lyrical flip here. Don't smile because it happened, cry because it's over. Where you get an actual proper glimpse behind all the glamour, and Sabrina Carpenter reveals just how much she has been hurt by the whole experience. Especially as, what's worst of all, is she's still probably holding a candle for this dude. And while the girlfriends around her are sympathetic, they're also taking shots. They're not that engaged to her pain, and it leads to a really lonely moment. I can't say I love the gauzy synth choice against the gentle acoustic groove, but I actually think it's melodically strong enough, especially in the vocal line, to hold up for this downbeat ending. Never thought I'd say that about Sabrina Carpenter, and while it's not close to my favorite, I appreciate Heartbreak executed well. It's fine. I'll take it. Number 32.
Does Mark record this in his
poetic
basement?
By Sabrina
Does
Carpenter.
He have a basement? Or is this like his house? Because like it looks like a basement, like the wall.
Every self-help book, you've already read it. Cherry pick lines like they're words you invented.
Okay, somebody needs to explain to me why the late Leonard Cohen became the lyrical target of some pop singer-songwriters.
Ooh, Megalo.
As much as I think he would have a grand chuckle at all their scathing abuse in his direction, I don't know when he became equivocated with pretentiousness, especially for faux introspective young dudes, when I could rattle off, frankly, dozens of others with far weaker catalogs and more hipster cred to boot. Mark Kozlik springs to mind. Anyway,
Ooh,
this
Megalo.
Barely feels like a song. Hazy acoustic, where Carpenter tries to get her Lana Del Rey impression on, but can't stop her vocals from sounding painfully girlish and weak along the way. And I never liked that
painfully
Lana
girlish?
The
What's wrong with
the lyrics
girlishness?
Are also considered to be a bit more cutting, where she rips into this guy who tries to play pretentious, which of course she's drawn to anyways. Insert the Dirtbag essay by Ann Powers here. It basically says everything I need to at this point. But the intriguing part of this song actually comes in the second verse, where it almost seems like it could be a response to Sabrina Carpenter with lines like, "You're so empathetic, you'd make a great wife," which alongside with the context of the rest of the verse could make for a cool inversion, but then you realize it's more likely that she's mocking his sensitive masculinity as disingenuous, as that kind of fits in the context with the hook entirely directed at him. Carpenter's brand of gender roles is so backwards looking it's kind of embarrassing, and really should have been highlighted more in the reviews. Basically, it feels like the junior varsity version of Norman Fucking Rockwell. I don't even love that song that much, but it's got more teeth.
Junior varsity. I just realized
number
it was junior varsity.
Slim
version.
Pickens by Sabrina Carpenter.
If I can't have the one I love, I guess it's you that I'll.
But this shit must be so awkward, like just recording these. Like, you just gotta stand there, like. Like, you're just standing there for like 3 minutes. Not even, probably even more. Like, they're probably recording for like 30 minutes, like just trying to get good clips. Maybe even hours. Like, look. Like, a lot of folks look, bro. They're like, "Oh yeah, this is the shit, bro." She's like on the glass. What
absolutely proves to me is that Jack Antonoff, relying on a bunch of airy atmospherics, cannot produce this brand of country music worth a damn. The acoustics, they have no weight, they have no warmth. The slide guitar and fiddle feels a little bit more like textured that line. Than anything deeper yeah, he's to the naked melody. In my room. And while the groove is.
Damn.
Okay, we're stuck with Sabrina Carpenter attempting a bunch of vocal runs in her upper register that do not impress me at all. But of course, this is the song where she is now openly complaining that there are so many dumb douchebags that want to date her, and she just keeps on fucking them because it's not like she's gonna try women or anything like that. It's just pickings out there. And you know, as much as I would like to be sympathetic to the struggles of celebrity dating, especially online for a rich hot blonde in her 20s in Los Angeles, having heard the full context of the album, I feel like some of this might be self-inflicted in choosing to date a bunch of messy dirtbags, and I don't have a lot of patience for serving up moaning and bitching at this point. I feel like there was a joke that she's attempting to make at her own expense that's just not landing for me. I just roll my eyes. Maybe I might have more sympathy for this if I didn't recognize this rant gender flipped from so many guys. Or if I wasn't in my 30s. But as it is, I get why it could work, but it's not working for me. Number 26, Coincidence by Sabrina Carpenter.
What a coincidence.
Sometimes you can actually get a jaunty, warm acoustic line that backs up a song with some sunny, throwback pop folk energy where the vocal tracking's a bit looser, yet still bright enough to let Sabrina Carpenter show off some tangible exasperation, one of the few emotions she can sell rather convincingly. The palette of the track is very reminiscent of Harry Styles. I kind of treat that as a compliment.
Yeah,
when you look at the producers, it shouldn't be a surprise. But honestly, the writing's decent too. She can very obviously
and
see
and
this swirl. Axe is going back to his old
partner. When is Harry Styles dropping? He's probably dropping next year, right?
It blew up in his face. It places Carpenter in the position where all she really has to do is make snide comments, and she's really good at that, too.
Can't
say it's my favorite, but it is decent for an album cut.
Thinking about
me.
Want
to know what's better? Number 22.
Juno from Overwatch? Carpenter. Makes sense. Juno is a baddie. Like, look what they got her doing, bruh. Like, you just like, oh yeah, I'm just standing here on a chair, like, I'm sitting here just chilling in the fucking garden. Like, what, bro?
Okay, I think this might be Sabrina Carpenter's best song, mostly because it's completely ridiculous and she seems to know that. One thing that she is unabashedly good at is expressing some playful verve in the bedroom, and this might be her most wildly horny song to date. She just outright says it on the bridge, and this guy is hot to the point where she's showing him off and flashing the toy handcuffs, to the point where she wants to get impregnated, and it almost feels like a fetish for her.
What the hell?
Now, the reference to Juno is admittedly kind of wild. That movie came out in the 2000s when she was 8 years old.
No, it's Overwatch, bro. What do you mean?
It was a Michael Cera cult hit at the time. Weird to say Michael Cera cult hit at all. I'm not sure how many people have thought about Juno since, beyond a thematic examination that really highlights how muddy its approach to teen pregnancy was. Maybe just kind of dated, which this song has no interest in unpacking, and I find that kind of hilarious too. But it also helps, it's just a really damn good pop song. I love the cooing embellishments around that pulsing guitar groove that feels imported straight from the cheapest of late 80s new wave teen pop, or maybe 80s Fleetwood Mac phoning it in. Emblematic of that wonky guitar solo tacked on before the final hook. Again, it is flighty, it's completely ridiculous, but Sabrina Carpenter kind of knows how to own that, at least here. I think it's a great song. If you haven't heard it, give it a shot.
I'm gonna go
number 21, Sharpest Tool
Sharpest.
By Sabrina Carpenter.
No, I'm not
if you think we're fine, you're confused and I'm upset, but we never talk about it.
This is the album where I discovered that it's real hard to defend Jack Antonoff when he's stuck with a singer who doesn't have the intensity to command the mix, and thus leaves her with production that exposes everything. So here we get the Aaron Dessner-esque soft focus, cycling acoustics and twinkles, and shuffling drum machine, and while that echoing reverb guitar has some presence, the dodgy vocal mix does not help. Even if I think she sells the angst of lack of communication reasonably well on the hook. Now granted, feels like a dick move to start off the song with, yeah, you're not the sharpest tool in the shed, even as she runs down his list of dubious behavior in the relationship and honestly doesn't have a lot of faith in her own intelligence. But I got a lot less patience for the melodrama here, because the weird silence, the uncomfortable ambiguity, the refusal to talk, it's all the more plain evidence of a bad relationship that she should have ended. Toxic vibes that don't remotely match the breezy atmosphere. It completely wrecks any sense of tension, even if the underlying emotions might be small or confused. I get what it's trying to do, I just don't think it lands. So yeah, I don't think it's good.
That was casual.
Hell, it's at least it's not. Number 15.
Chaperone Reference.
Good Graces by Sabrina Carpenter.
Good Graces. Gracie Abrams. Sounds like an Ariana Grande type song, no? Am I crazy?
They're trying to make a Jessica Simpson song by way
I guess Jessica Simpson.
That chirpy melody, the faster cymbal.
I don't know why this reminds me of Ariana Grande. There must be one song where that might have more bounce,
but brings it down with some.
What song does this remind me of? What Ariana Grande song does this sound like?
I'm not usually a fan of mean girl pop as it is, but if you're going to do it, have some edge. Give the Venom some intensity. Not the
Venom
sounding. You better be nice to me, or I'll just ruin your life. You know, where it sounds like. She is way more interested in doing the latter. Hell, she might just do it for fun. And the line on the second verse about going to go fuck his favorite athlete, that's a big crack to that veneer of the cool every girl. It's another reason why the Jessica Simpson comparison springs to mind. I just don't believe it. You lose that hot every girl veneer when you start trafficking in celebrity drama and then try to pass it off as normal. We don't need another Jenny from the block. So yeah, absolutely sucks. Fortunately, next up we got number 14, Bed Chem by Sabrina Carpenter. Okay, look, if Sabrina Carpenter is going to make the cheap version of late 90s R&B-inflected teen pop with the rollicking bass, the chimes, the G-funk touches, the choppy scratching on the breakdown, and the half-rap delivery on the second verse, even if her upper register is too shrill to fit this soft-focus mix, this is way too close to my personal nostalgia window to really dislike, especially when Carpenter can largely sell the goofy sex references. Now, I stand by bed chem being an impressively stupid phrase, but the entire song is dumb in a silly enough way that I can largely overlook it, maybe even find some charm. The meet cute that I can already tell if they're shooting in the music video, it's gonna be shot in slow motion. The stupid sex jokes on the second verse and the double entendres on the bridge, where if it was not a pop star making this, I'd say it's one or two more jokes away from being a Lonely Island parody of this sound. But honestly, if Sabrina Carpenter wanted to be the looser and less serious pop starlet where the humor allows her to play both into and against type, that's kind of a fun lane. I miss pop that's got some goofy levity, and Carpenter's pretty good at it. I wouldn't mind her. I see her value now. Case in point, finally, number 2, Taste by Sabrina Carpenter.
Guys, I reacted to this video on my main channel. Please go watch it.
The only reason this charted so high was the music video was just trying to do a Death Becomes Her riff. What is Sabrina Carpenter's taste in movies with these muddy gender politics? It's probably the song with the most muscle on the entire project, where she's basically taunting the girl returning to Sabrina's ex that, of course, he's still thinking about Sabrina. And the reason that Morgan Wallen didn't get away with this premise is because Sabrina Carpenter's not playing it that seriously, and this has a largely upbeat tone. It's nowhere near as sour as Thinking About Me. Now, that doesn't excuse the snotty, capricious energy that underscores the song, because I don't really
think about me clears the song, unfortunately.
Really impugn the guy in the circumstance. And outside of the hazy context of the album and the music video, there's no actual evidence he cheated on Sabrina with this former partner. It's just an implication. So the song feels really petty. Thankfully, the sharper electric guitar groove is pretty solid, with the post-chorus as that cool reverbed echo. And Sabrina Carpenter can sell that kind of pettiness. I get why it was positioned as the next single, but I'm only going to call it decent. Can't say a lot more. But all right, that's our week. And the best and the worst, they fall out real damn fast, and Sabrina Carpenter is taking all of them. For the worst, Lie to Girls easily has the top spot, followed by Good Graces as a dishonorable mention. For the best, Juno's running away with it, with a Bed Chem as the honorable mention.
All right.
Next week, we'll see how much any of this lasts as the summer ends and the album bomb fades. Stay tuned for that. But until then, I'm Mark.
You're watching Billboard Breakdown. Affiliated with Spectral Pulse. I'll see you next time. I'll see you next time, too. What was I going to say? Guys, go subscribe to Billboard Breakdown. Go subscribe to Spectral Pulse. Go follow them everywhere. Twitter, Blue Sky, Tumblr, TikTok, whatever. Subscribe to me. Goodbye.